the place, and so wonderful to hear that Megan is back in somewhere close to where I am right now. And so that's a new thing, and that makes us happy. And it reminds us of the great community that's gathered around this church and the love that we share for each other. So if there are any visitors, we're so glad that you're here, and hope that we can learn more about you and that this service will provide meaning in your life. The theme today in our worship has to do with lament, Psalms of Lament, its place in our lives, what is important about being able to be honest with God and express our grief and our pain, and ask the question, how long? As it happens, I got a call on my way to church this morning from Betty Peterson. And they had called her yesterday. I was talking to Betty yesterday, and she told me that they'd called and said that Marshall was sleeping too much and not eating. And then I got a call this morning saying that she needed to come to the facility, that Marshall was dying. We will pray more for them in our prayer time. But as this happens in our life and other things, it seems very fitting. Chris, if you want to put up the cover that we have as our theme today, Lament. And I invite you to look at this picture and gather up the emotions that picture offers to you when things are hard. And then there are two centering thoughts by Walter Brueggemann, the foremost expert in Psalms. And as you begin to hear this centering music from Mary Lee, I invite you to read these centering thoughts. So let us worship God.
Streams above.
Thank you, Mary Lee. Now let us join together in a responsive call to worship. These are words briefly describing some of the key meanings of what the Psalms are from Walter Brueggemann. Life is a constant process of orientation or equilibrium. Disorientation and then reorientation. All of these experiences are represented by different categories of psalms. Psalms of lament emerge from the experience of disorientation. They express the pain, grief, dismay, and anger that life is not good. They also refuse to settle for things as they are, and so they assert hope. Our opening hymn is, "O Our God, Our Help in Ages Past." Thank you, Pat. And now may the peace of Christ be with you and also with you. You may unmute and share the peace of Christ. Peace of Christ to all who are with us today. It's so good to be together in Christ's love.
Amen.
And Chris, we can mute again. And Mary Lee has another offering for our special music.
And your life seems so like a frantic race, and you sometimes think you just can't stand the strain. When a trifle threatens to blow your mind, and relief is something you cannot find, and you cannot get yourself together again, you better stop. store. Close your eyes, see the vision in his word for everyone who waits upon the Lord. It's a vision of flying like an eagle, running and not being weary, walking and not fainting at all. Flying like an eagle, running and not being weary. He who saves you will not let you fall. Aspirin that you took last night doesn't really help you to feel all right, and there's just no use in trying anymore. When the world has torn your defense away and you cannot make it another day, and your life lies bruised and broken on the floor, you better stop. Let it all go for a while. Do you need your strength to be restored? Close your eyes, see the vision in his word for everyone who waits upon the Lord. It's a vision of flying like an eagle, running and not being weary, walking and not fainting at all. Flying like an eagle, running and not being weary. He who saves you will not let you
Thank you, Mary Lee. That was beautiful. I wonder if anybody besides me and the songwriter, that Ken Medema, that wrote that piece, are feeling just overwhelmed. Police shootings, racism running wild at the highest levels of our society. Truth is a stranger. Separation and isolation because of the virus. An illness in our congregation. Over the next 3 weeks, I want to try to help myself. And I want to try to help you deal with this present pain and dislocation that we are all experiencing these days. Today, we will ask, how long is this all going to last? We will ask in this sermon today, where is God? Our guest preacher is Theresa Latini. She is the executive director of the Mount Olivet Retreat Center in Farmington. Next week, we will engage with the plague of racism. We will do so by going back in time to hear words from the heart, the very heart of the civil rights struggle in the last century. Our speaker, the words that we hear may surprise some of us. It is LBJ, Lyndon Baines Johnson. His words will declare with remarkable courage and clarity what is needed in our struggle now. And in 2 weeks, we will grapple with maybe our biggest obstacle of all, the facing of our challenges, and that is fear. With the help of an African-American theologian and professor, we will ask the question, can we face the future without fear? On all of these Sundays, it is my hope that our flock may be comforted and empowered and drawn together and given hope. So let us now be led by Reverend Landini in the spoken word and in the sermon for today. And it'll take just a second. We've discovered that it's best for me to run this. And so Tessa's going to be making sure I do all the right steps. So Tessa, I do the screen share first, right?
Yep.
Here it is.
Did you hit full screen, Gwen? There you go.
Our first scripture reading for this morning comes from Psalm 13. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I bear pain in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all day long? How long shall my enemy be exalted over me? Consider and answer me, O Lord my God. Give light to my eyes, or I will sleep the sleep of death. And my enemy will say, I have prevailed. My foes will rejoice because I am shaken. But I trusted in your steadfast love. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord because the Lord has dealt bountifully with me. Our second reading for the day comes from Romans chapter 8, beginning with verse 31. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? God, who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Jesus Christ who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake, we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Let us pray. Lord God, this day, as we are together, even as we are apart, may your Spirit bring your word to life for us and in us and through us, that we might know you and love you and serve you to the best of our ability. Through Christ our Lord we pray. Amen. About once each week, my 6-year-old daughter, Eleanor, goes on a tirade about the coronavirus. She has a litany of angry complaints against this microscopic infective agent. She can't play with her friends. She can't see her grandparents. She has to do more online school in the fall. She can't get close to people outside of her pod, those that we've sheltered with. She doesn't like wearing a mask. It's hot and barely stays on at times. And she is sick of keeping away from people, even though she's got a really good internal sense of what 6 feet looks like. Eleanor's lament sometimes begins and or ends with an emphatic, "I hate the coronavirus," or the stronger, "I want to kill the coronavirus." The first time she said that one, I gulped a bit, while admitting to myself with a twinge of pride that she sounded a little bit like a younger version of me. Now, after the rant come the tears and the longing. When will we be able to get close to other people? When will the coronavirus leave? When will there be a vaccine? On good days, Eleanor also tells me with great specificity what we need to do when the long waiting finally comes to an end. "Mom," she says, "if you're watching the news at night and they say there is a vaccine, then you need to wake me up right away, even if I cry and whine because I don't want to get up. Wake me up and tell me the good news. Then, Mom, we need to get dressed, and we need to brush our teeth, and we need to go to the place where they give vaccines. After we get our shots, we're going to look and see," and then she names all of her people that she misses, "see if they also got a shot. And if there's a Band-Aid on their shoulder, I'm gonna run up to them and hug them. And then, Mom, after that, we have to go to my school, and I'm gonna hug the building. And then I wanna go to a playground and get on the monkey bars. Okay, Mom?" "You got it, Eleanor," I say. "We'll do all of that." Sometimes, most times, the tears return. "But when, Mom?" The psalmist says it this way, "How long, O Lord? How long?" Now, in my best moments, I empathize with my daughter. I let her know that I hear her sadness and her madness, and I can hear how much she wants closeness with those she loves and the freedom to run and play with abandon instead of caution. Now, at other times, the educator in me comes out, and I try to answer that question of when. "The governor of Minnesota will tell us when it's safe," I say. Or, "Dr. Fauci said something like this when he was asked that question. He said, we don't set the timeline, the virus sets the timeline." You know, I actually tried explaining that to her one night, and it went over about as well as it goes over for most people in our country. At other times, I try to encourage Eleanor and remind her of her own resilience. "You and I have done hard things before, kiddo. We can do this too. We're not alone. A lot of people all over the world are wearing masks and social distancing and not getting too close to their loved ones. So many kids are not going back to school in their buildings. It's hard. We don't like it, but we can do it because we love other people and we love ourselves and we love God." If I'm honest, I feel like Eleanor on more days than I tend to admit. I feel the weariness of it all, what they keep calling COVID fatigue. I don't like being constrained. I miss my loved ones. I worry about the future, and I dread the return of online schooling, even as I recognize its necessity. How long, O Lord? How long? Will it be a year? Longer? How much worse will it get? At the time of today's recording, over 5 million people in the United States alone have contracted COVID. And we are on course, the experts tell us, for up to 300,000 deaths from this disease by November. How long, O Lord? How long? I just managed, it seems, to survive online kindergarten and have spent months redeveloping the offerings and practices here at Mount Olivet Conference and Retreat Center, where I'm the executive director. And in these two vocations, how long gets paired with how can I best care for my daughter in the midst of her worry and grief? And how can we continue our ministry of healing and hospitality and rest without becoming exhausted ourselves? How long, O Lord, how long? Deborah Hunsinger, a dear friend and seminary professor of mine from years ago, wrote in her book on prayer that lament means directing one's anguish toward God. In this sense, lament is courageous. It's faith's alternative to despair. It is honest, gut-wrenching, vulnerable. It's a complaint in the very presence of God that paradoxically buoys us up in hope. A friend of mine once said something to me that I've never forgotten, another friend. He said, "When I'm depressed, I listen to the blues, and eventually I feel better." Now, I am by no means a blues aficionado, but I knew what he meant, that the poetic articulation of grief in song can soothe the soul. Lament is like that. It too is soothing. It's not optimism. It's not denial. It's not minimization. It's not some kind of reassurance that fails to reassure. And it's certainly not some assertion of invincibility. I'm going to defy the experts and the virus itself and not wear masks or social distance. Come and get me, virus. No, there's too much of that. And none of it is rooted in or comes from or contributes to hope. But lament? That does. It's a doorway to hope. In times when we feel desperate and overwhelmed and helpless, and it's built right into the fabric of authentic Christian faith. Of the 150 Psalms, which are sometimes called the prayer book of the Bible, 42 of these at least are lament Psalms. When we lament after the psalmists, we direct our anguish to God and even at God. We rail against God. There's no sugarcoating of our experiences or our feelings when we lament. No Minnesota niceness to be found here. Hello, God. How long will you fail to act? How long will you let us languish? How many deaths and disrupted lives are enough? Also, when we lament, we tell God to remember who God is, and in so doing, we remember too. You are our healer. You are our redeemer. You are our provider. You are our wisdom. You are our deliverer. Now do it, because we can't. When we lament, we protest the absence of God in the midst of our distress. Jesus said it best on the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me? Though it might not sound like it, lament is full of hope. Every rant in lament represents a refusal to let go of our deepest longings, even when desperate and overwhelmed. Again, my professor wrote, "When healing fails, lament is the hopelessness that refuses to give up hope. When injustice prevails, lament is the protest that digs in for the long haul. When humiliation abounds, lament is the self-respect that cries out to a hidden God, 'How long, O Lord?'" Lament is an act of public protest. Could you hear the lament in the waves of protest against the killing of George Floyd and so many others, against police brutality and systemic racism? How long, O Lord? How long, O Church? How long, United States of America? These protests are anguish and outrage expressed through hands and feet and voices and sometimes even through silence. Lament is moral outraged in indignation wrapped in hope, a hope that comes from placing our gaze upon God. A hope that comes from actively remembering God's promises. A hope that comes from not letting go of God until we are spent. Lament focuses on God and engages God with honesty and vulnerability and integrity. So that when we lament to God, we acknowledge that things are not the way we desire, not the way they should be, not the way God intends. And in articulating all of that, we discover, as another theologian said, that it is safe to love God and to find hope in being loved by God. It is safe to love God and to find hope in being loved by God. But I trusted in your steadfast love, the psalmist eventually says. Lament flows from a reservoir of trust in God's love, and it keeps hope alive. Such hope is a gift that we receive. It comes from God. And so, on days when I wish I could comfort my daughter and somehow give her hope, and on days when I wish for a more just and equitable world, on days when I wish that we could communally mourn the loss of so many lives, I remember that hope, as well as faith and love, comes from God. And so I lament and wait, along with the psalmists and the communion of saints who have been praying the Psalms for thousands of years. We are not alone, my friends. Today, may we lament together and wait upon God to answer us. Amen.
In this powerful word that we have heard from Teresa, we have cried out to God. And how could it be any different that God will answer us with another psalm? If you will take your, if Chris will post the hymn, you will see that we're going to sing a hymn that is based on the 23rd Psalm.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pat. Friends, we come now to joys and concerns of the church. I would like to offer a prayer request. As I look out at the sanctuary and see all of you beautiful and active Christians, and I think about the way our lives are constrained about actually doing things that can help, and because that's in our nature in this community to try to make a difference, it occurs to me that I would like to offer a prayer for our democracy. And in doing so, and thinking about you and this congregation's history of activism, I am gripped by the reality that democracies are based on voting, that to vote is to be democratic. And at the highest levels of our government, there is this effort to suppress the vote, which in my opinion means to suppress democracy. So I would like to encourage you to find ways online to see how you could support the Get Out the Vote movement. There are ways that they have phone banks where you simply call and in a friendly way say, have you registered to vote? We're just wanting to make sure that everyone votes. There are different organizations that are doing that. And so I would just like to encourage you this week to Google that, go online. If anybody that's listening on this worship service knows more than me in terms of specifics, please chime in at this point. But if not, those are things that we can find. And let's make our democracy work no matter who is elected. But let's have the person elected because people could vote, not because they can't vote. And so let's put our shoulder to that, folks, and see what how many different votes we can get that wouldn't have happened if we didn't get active about it. So let's pray for that by saying, oh, God, hear our prayer. All right. If you, Chris, will put up the Lord's Prayer. This is our Celtic version. And we will pray it together. Let us pray. Ground of all being, mother of life, father of the universe, your name is sacred beyond speaking. May we know your presence. May your longings be our longings in heart and in action. Today, may there be food for the human family and for the whole earth community. Forgive us the falseness of what we have done, as we forgive those who are untrue to us. Do not forsake us in our time of conflict, but lead us into new beginnings. For the light of life, the vitality of life, and the glory of life are yours now and forever. Amen. Now we have our prayer of dedication that we say in unison, remembering our offerings and pledges and the work that they do to further God's kingdom on earth. So let us pray this prayer of dedication together. As we bring this offering, O Lord, we acknowledge that what we give and what we keep for ourselves is all from you and belongs to you. Help us to use your gifts as may best complete your purposes and be of most benefit to your world. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now I invite from the congregation any announcements that you may have. Receive now the benediction and then we will have our going out song. May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God's countenance be lifted up upon you, both now and always. And may all God's people say, Amen.